فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, living in America, at the end of a year, the coming of a new year, the social circles are normally addressing, how can I be a better person next year? So-called New Year resolutions. I'm not condoning any of that, by the way, just to start, but we get affected. We find also Muslims speaking like this. And you find that all the resolutions are around one question: where can I find true happiness? If you know the following facts, that one of every 10 Americans reported depression, one out of every 10 Americans, and I'm not talking about Muslims, are suffering from depressions. People who die out of suicide are more than the people who die out of homicide. Homicide, yani being killed, whether by a car accident or shot. So people who end their lives in America are more than the people who get their lives ended at the hands or through other. So you can tell there is a trend of unhappiness. People are not happy. In spite of the resources and the means that we have in America, how come? Because they are seeking it in the wrong place. Ideally now, drugs. Americans now craving for drugs. And what they end up finding? that, yeah, they get bummed for an hour, the duration of feeling high, and after that, it's gone. You know, when you smoke, and I know I'm having a lot of youth here in the community today, and in the mosque today, and I'm talking to them. This is the culture in the public schools now, that you have to take a smoke, you have to get a joint to feel high, because the culture is saying this is how you can become happy. Now, yeah, it's going to bump you for an hour, it's going to blow you for an hour, and then at the end what? You're going to find yourself sick. And if you get addicted, if you get hooked up on it, you cannot really support that habit. It's very expensive, especially if you upgrade. And guess what? If you upgrade, you cannot leave it. And now to support it, you have to commit crimes. You have to steal money. So this is certainly not the way to happiness. And at the end of the day, we find a lot of people who are on drugs, they end up killing themselves. So there is no happiness in drugs, really. It's a fake happiness. Some people, they say happiness is in money, in collecting more money. Just the day before yesterday, I read a piece of news. I don't know if it's correct or not. I haven't really investigated the matter. A billionaire threw himself out of a skyscraper in New York. I don't know if you came across this or not. A billionaire jumped out of the window of a skyscraper in the city of New York, and guess what? He owns the skyscraper. Imagine he built the skyscraper, so just think about it. If money is, listen, money is necessary. Money is a key to a lot of things. But it's not what buys you happiness. Some, especially the youth, again, I'm addressing my youth, the youth of my community here. They believe that happiness is in music. Happiness is in music, is listening to that hard rock and that, you know, and yeah, it does affect you emotionally, the duration of the music. But after that, what? Can you take that music with you when you're taking a test? You can't. And if you really want to figure out whether music is a way to be happy, ask the musicians. 90% of them are on drugs. For them to produce that music that you're hearing, they get high. And they are not happy people. And if you really want to figure this out, read the story of someone who used to be the king in the American society, the king of hard rock, I believe, whose name is Cat Stevens. Read his story, dear youth, Cat Stevens. Americans know him quite well. His name is now Yusuf Islam. He tells you that I couldn't find, there is a hollow, there is emptiness inside me. So it is not music. It is not money. It is not drugs. It is not in unlawful sexual relationships. If really happiness is in that, then I'm sorry to use the term, prostitutes would be the happiest people in the face of this earth. But they are miserable. A lot of young men now, a lot of Muslims, they think happiness is just knowing more girls and hanging around them and having that unlawful relationship. No, happiness is not there either. Yeah, there is a little bump, but you feel the misery afterwards. What else? Sport, your team doesn't win all the time. They end up hiring their own coach, they lose the game, then you become depressed. Where is that happiness then? Where do you find happiness? Where is the true path to happiness? Well, first, let's define what happiness is. So we know what we're talking about. What do you mean by happiness? They say happiness is a contented state of mind where the individual experiences inner peace even at times of difficulty and hardship and torture. That is what happiness is. Again, a contented شعور بالسرور يعني, state of mind that somehow you're relaxed, you're chilling. A state of mind, a contented state of mind where the individual experiences inner peace, that you relax. Even in situations where people would look at to be a torture. You know when Bilal was dragged on the Ramda on the desert? That is the you know Bilal, the Abyssinian disciple of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who used to be a slave when he accepted Islam. His master started persecuting him in the desert in Mecca. He used to drag him at noon. And if you've been to Hajj, you would know how hot this is. It's like fire. Drag him on his belly, naked, and he's saying, Ahadun Ahad. Ahadun Ahad. Imagine inner peace that enable you to take that heat, to take that persecution, and yet you're giving the one who's persecuting you a hard time. It just that is so. Happiness really is irrelevant, is a state of mind, has nothing to do with what you have and what you do not have. And I'm sorry, I'm being a little bit into the Western, approach today. Somebody whose name is Stephen Covey, I read a statement for him. He said this: happiness that you look at every situation in your life to be win-win. That you're winning. Regardless of what the situation is. There are a lot of people who see every opportunity a problem. But there are people who see out of every problem there is an opportunity. True, that you're having a problem, you see potential opportunity in that problem. I'll share with you a story that I heard last weekend. It's not yani always min barakat al-ilm that you attribute it to the person who says it. I was in the ECNA conference in Chicago, and I sat and I listened to one of the scholars there, and he mentioned that story, which really serves what I'm trying to convey here. There was that mule, the animal, walking, and the people somehow dug a ditch in the ground, a ditch, hufra, so the mule fall down in the ditch, deep ditch. Imagine a mule, 4 wheels, 4 feet yani, having to go out of that ditch. That's a big problem. Not only this, the people decided that they must fill that ditch with dirt, because they are afraid that someone else may, yani they are afraid that some human would be walking and fall in that ditch. They said, let's fill it with dirt. They are not aware that there is a mule inside it. So they went and they got buckets of dirt, and they started throwing dirt on the hole on the top of the mule. That's not only I'm down here, these guys are going to bury me alive. What should I do? He said, every time they throw dirt on my back, I'm going to shake it off and I'm going to step on it. He kept doing that. As they are filling the hole with dirt, he kept rising, and he's out. That is the attitude of a happy person. That you look at every situation to be good, to be positive, regardless. Now, this is a very difficult concept. I'm sorry. Very easy to say, but very hard to implement. Unless you have higher principles that guide this. 1400 plus years ago, one of the disciples of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who spent most of his life in Rome, whose name is Suhaib ibn Sinan Rumi, Abi Yahya, recorded these three principles. He heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioning these three principles, and he recorded them. And the Imam Muslim compiled the hadith. What did he hear? قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, عجبا لأمر المؤمن فإن أمره كله له خير. The lifestyle, all the affairs of a true believers, of a true believer, is amazing. It's all beneficial. That's the win-win here. It's all good. The lifestyle of a believer is all good. إن أصابته نعماء, when he is given, when he is win. Not loss, win. Remember, win-win. When he is winning, shakar, he shows gratitude. He's grateful. Tayyib, when he is losing, yani according to the common look of people to everything, وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءُ, when he's inflicted with a calamity, sabr, he is patient. فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ, and it is good for him. So the three higher principles here that can grant you that state of mind, win-win all the time, iman, faith, gratitude, shukr, patience, sabr. You can be grateful, you can be patient, but without faith, it's not going to work. Because faith gives the motive. By the way, going back to Western, and I promise you this is the last time I'm going to go back there. They actually did some study regarding religion and being believing in something, believing in a religion. So when they looked into the amount of depression in the community, and I'm taking all of this, by the way, by the American magazine of some public health, something like that. I just got all of this from the net. They said they studied different groups to find out the reason why there is a higher rate of depression in America. Well, first of all, they attributed depression to stress, you being stressed out. They found out that people who are religious are less stressed than the people who are not. So the people who have religion, the rate of depression is lesser than a secular, for example, or somebody who does not believe in any religion. They actually condone this. They say, yes, religion affects the individual positively. Now, what is Iman here? What is faith? What is the definition of faith and how to attain it? Our scholars said faith, believe in the hearts, a statement by the tongue, an application by the limbs. That is what faith is. So, اعتقاد في القلب, that you believe in the heart. Two, that belief drives you to utter the statement. You stand out there and you say, I'm a believer. You're not going to shy away from it. I am a believer. I'm a Muslim. If your name is Muhammad, it's not going to turn miraculously into Mu because you want to hide your character. No, your name stays Muhammad. And you look like a Muslim. You present yourself like a Muslim. Statement with the tongue. And you do this, you attest to that belief in the heart with the outer limbs, with the outward actions. You pray, you fast, and so forth. Now, to make sure that you're believing in the right deity, you must learn. So what triggers faith really in the heart is knowledge. Where they go like, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Learn لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Learn it. And that is why, ya ikhwa, the scholars always started with this. Tawheed, 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 tawheed. Because listen, you may end up worshipping the wrong deity. This is called faith, too. But the impact will be lesser. Besides, you lose the hereafter, which is a higher goal. You may end up praying to the created instead of praying to the creator. We have people in the face of this earth, when they supplicate in the names of created, like angels, like prophets and messengers, ideally our neighbors, and we say this in a respectful way, when they make the supplications in the name of the Father, they mean God, the created, but yet they associate with him, they associate with him, created, Son, Holy Ghost, which is Jibreel, an angel. La. So, the way to attain the proper faith, the proper belief, is knowledge. You must learn who is Allah, who is the right deity, the correct deity you should worship. And that is why, when you stand up and you make that statement with your tongue, guess what you say? I bear witness, ashhadu, I bear witness that there is no deity, no God. And this is a key, by the way. A Muslim must negate before he affirms no God, no deity. You must negate, nafi, nafyun aam, no God, no deity, worthy of my worship, except one. You see that? You see that formula? That is why a Muslim cannot believe that Allah is the God, and there is Buddha, and there is Jesus, and there is the Son, and la 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 la. You have not learned la ilaha illallah. You have not. Listen, I'm not asking you to be mean to Buddhism or Buddhist and Christian. I'm not saying that. I'm saying about the way that belief should sit in your heart. You must first dismiss that there is any deity, any object, any God deserving my worship, deserving my submission, except one God, which is Allah. La ilaha, la ilaha, no God, no God, no God, no God deserves my submission except Allah. So when you make that statement, now we come to the word worship. We live in a culture, in a society that confines worship to the sanctuaries, a church, a synagogue, a mosque. You go to the mosque, you worship, you come outside. La. Worship in Islam, every place, you're a servant of Allah. You're a worshiper. When you go to sleep, you're a worshiper. When you eat, you're a worshiper. When you drink, you're a worshiper. And this is what the people say, Islam is a lifestyle. Ya ikhwa, big problem if you confine worship to just going to the masjid, pray two rak'ahs, and khalas, outside. And this is unfortunately what's going on with our youth. You have two characters. In the masjid, again, the whole khutbah is to my youth today, because I know they are off and they are here. They, in the masjid, in the house, mashallah, and they give you all these nice Islamic terms, and when they go out, oh, dude, you know that stuff, man? You got this, man? It's different culture, different. It's like, you know that bipolar thing? You know, you're having two characters? La. A Muslim is 24-7. 24-7, regardless. You're striving, and I'm not saying that you're going to be perfect. You're going to flunk in some cases. We all do flunk. But we have a Lord who forgives. If you commit a sin, you go back to Him. فهذه الإيمان. Now, it increases and decreases. If you want to boost your faith, your iman, just engage in worship. Pray, recite the Quran, and so forth. Whenever you indulge in disobedience, in sinning, that faith goes down. So that's the first element, the first principle, the belief in Allah. And what comes with it? That there is a next life, and so forth. The second concept here, or the second principle, is gratitude. And again, I'm sorry, this is the last time I'm going to go back to that thing. You know, I did some interesting study. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran first, وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you have gratitude, if you're grateful, I will increase you, I'll give you more. I'll give you more. Businesses, listen to this, and if you're a businessman now, businesses who send a thank you note, a thank you letter to the customers after they visit, after they come to your business, normally they have an increase in their business of 60%. Just to show you that it's even so, it's a Quranic principle, but wallahi, I want to tell you something. They apply everything in the Quran and the Sunnah. Our neighbors and our, they do, somehow, they got it, sir. I don't know how, they got it. That's why you go and you go to the doctor, and as soon as you arrive home, 2 days late, thank you for visiting our, man, this is cool. I'm going back to that place, this is nice. What is this? Wala in shakartum. Huh? Isn't that what's in the Quran? If you're grateful, if you show gratitude, I'll give you more. Oh, you get business, you get customers coming back to you. The key, brothers and sisters in Islam, to being grateful. And I'm telling you, this is a big problem that we Muslims do have these days. You know, when you have a cup, some of it is empty. Like they say, you're always looking at the empty what? Side. We fail to see what we have. That is why psychiatrists, they tell you, just before complaining, look at this. Before you complain about your condition, I want you to list 10 good things that you have. Before you complain, list, name 10 good things that you have. MashaAllah, I'm wearing this. That is one. Alhamdulillah, I'm healthy. Alhamdulillah. I had breakfast. Alhamdulillah. I have a car. Alhamdulillah. Huh? I have kids. Alhamdulillah. Before you complain. Before you. Ya ikhwa, I want to tell you something. And this came with the Salatul Duha, that when you pray Duha, you're paying sadaqah for each limb of your body. Now, after the medicine is turning into using the body parts into, they break your body into parts and they seal it. Imagine the heart is how much? How much is the heart now? Huh? If you seal your heart. But if you seal your hand, if you seal your nail, if you seal your head, if you seal your brain, if you seal your leg, huh, how much you're worth? You're an expensive one. See what you have if you want to be happy. Number two, you must believe that whatever you have is from Allah. Because you didn't earn it on your own. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever you have of a bounty is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three, look at this now. Number three, look at this. The Sunnah teaches us that if you really want to show gratefulness or gratitude, this got to be manifested in your relationship with the people. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, fi Sunan al-Tirmidhi, hadith Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, look at this. Man la yashkuru an-nasa la yashkuru Allah. If you're not grateful to people, you will never be grateful to Allah. Somebody does you a favor, somebody who helps you, and you cannot say Jazakallahu khayran to him, you cannot say thank you to him. Now you're expecting to say thank you to Allah. The manifestation of gratitude should be expressed to the people around you, to your wife. Have you ever said Jazakallahu khairan to your wife lately? Have you ever said thank you to her that she's taking care of the house? That she's cleaning your bed? That she's taking care of your children? Have you ever done that lately? Huh? Brothers? Your children, your kids, Jazakallahu khair. Thank you. That is number four. Another piece quickly here, because my time is running out, is in order to maintain the attitude of gratitude, of being grateful, always look at the people who are lower than you. Imagine you're driving a Ford, one of these small Fordy or Hyundai, and you're driving in the road. And to the right of you, there is a Ferrari or Porsche. And to the left, there is maybe a little tiny car. Which one should you look at? If you look at the Porsche, you know that Porsche car, something is German car, I think, or Ferrari or what? Oh, man, how come I don't have like this man? Huh? That's not fair. He's better than me. But look at the one left to you. وهذا في الحديث هذا في البخاري Rasul sallallahu hadith Abi Huraira, the messenger of Allah, just to let you know that everything is coming from the Quran and the Sunnah. The messenger says, if you want to look to those who are lower than you. فَإِنَّهُ أَجْدَرَ أَلَّا تَزْدَرِي نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ. This will lead you not to belittle the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. لأن يا إخوة, when you go through hardship, when you're not having a fun life, always it's better to remember that everybody is going through hardship. يعني الخنساء, when her brothers died, were killed in one battle, some 5-6 I think brothers were killed. ولولا كثرة الباكين حولي على إخوانهم لقتلت نفسي. She had like a 5-6 brothers killed. She said, has it been for the people also around me crying over their brothers, I would have killed myself. ولذلك القرآن also came to the people in the hellfire telling them what? وَلَنْ يَنْفَعَكُمُ الْيَوْمَ إِذْ ظَلَمْتُمْ أَنَّكُمْ فِي الْعَذَابِ مُشْتَرِكُونَ. يعني that feeling is going to be taken away in hellfire. Allah is telling them, listen, the fact that you're going to be seeing other people punished in front of you is not going to lessen the punishment psychologically. You're still going to feel it. One of the first things that when people come complain about, you know, family issues, is, you know what? Yesterday I had two cases like this. You're not one of a kind. Right away, relax, chill. I'm not the only one suffering here. The third principle, brothers and sisters in Islam, in closing, is patience. And this is the key. Because it's not always win-win. Sometimes we go through hardships. And we're here to be tested in this world. So be patient. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give glad tidings to those who are patient. Now, some people are born patient. But some people, they are not patient. What should they do? Practice patience. Pretend to be patient. Not in the fashion of showing off, but pretending like, okay, I'm going to be patient. You're angry, you're upset, I'm going to be patient. Practice. That's what they say, practice creates perfect. So this is the true way to happiness in this world. Not only in this world, but success in the hereafter. If you possess the proper beliefs and you're grateful and you're patient, you're not only going to be possessing inner peace or that contented state of mind in this world, rather you earn, inherit the hereafter, which is Jannah. And this is the way to go, brothers and sisters in Islam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم. Brothers and sisters in Islam, token of a change, token of becoming happy and bitter bitter individuals, we as a community need to also change collectively. We need to be bitter community in America. We need to benefit our neighbors, our co-workers. And I'm only asking you to practice the revelation. I'll share with you something that happened yesterday that upset me the whole day. I'm not going to name anybody. A Muslim brother hired a Mexican to do a job for him. The Mexican ended up working 12 hours a day for a whole week. He was promised $13 an hour. And guess what? He also got his wife with him, working for 2 days. The brother, the Muslim brother, got what he wanted from him, and he disappeared. He vanished. Imagine yesterday. Here is really what upsetted me, brothers and sisters in Islam. Yesterday, that Mexican who only speaks Spanish, he does not speak English, he brought with him his 9 years old to translate. When I was hearing from this little boy the complaint, متى يبلغ البنيان يوما تمامه إذا كنت تبني وغيرك يهدمه. 9 years old, your people took away the wage of my father and my mother. We want it. We can give lectures, thousands, hundreds of lectures. Wallahi, that scene will stay in the mind of that little boy. And it may be the reason that hinders him to receive guidance from Allah. When are we going to practice the religion? When are we going to practice our deen? When Islam is going to be transcended into real life? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثَلَاثَةٌ أَنَا خَصْمُهُمْ وَمَنْ كُنْتُ خَصْمَهُ قَصَمْتُ. 3 types of people. I'm their enemy in the day of resurrection. Imagine Allah, Malik Yawm al-Din, is your enemy in the day of resurrection. يا أخي أرح ولدك يعني خذه بارك الله فيك. One of them, رجل استأجر أجيرا. Someone who hired somebody to do a job for him. فاستوفى منه ثم أكل حقه. Then he got what he wants, then he did not pay him. Imagine. We got to practice our deen if we want to make a difference in where we live. We're struggling to better our picture, to fit, and we're not practicing. Listen, I have, you know, the issue is, we have been trying to call the brother to validate the story of the Mexican, quite frankly. Because so far we have not heard from the brother. But our sister, Jazallah Khair, in the office, has been trying to call him. I tried to call him personally. He's not picking up. He's not answering. I left him messages. Listen, so far, what the Mexican has presented to us is allegations. Are allegations. I have to validate it first, because you always have to hear both sides of the story. But he's not answering us. He's not responding. That means there are some legitimacy. But this is the dark side. I want to cheer you up before you leave. Last weekend, compare this with this. Last weekend, the property which the community owns, the Colfax community owned property. Community owned property, not Imam Karim property. The property on Chamber and Islip. We purchased it for $410,000. We didn't have the money. We given the owner $150,000, and we told him, please give us a year to raise the money for you. Please. He said, I'm very concerned. I never dealt with Muslims before. In any rate, we were supposed to pay him off April 2014. Next year, yeah. Alhamdulillah, Allah has guided us, supported us. We raised the money. We have the money sitting in the bank. You know, we as Muslims, we cannot benefit from money in banks. We don't receive interest. It's usury. It's unlawful. So the money is in the bank sitting. The man has been, quite frank, he's a non-Muslim. Non-Muslim. He's been so helpful. A little creek out there, we ask him, what is going to take to build? He got us a study already ready. We had some trees that we have to move from somewhere to. He's been so helpful. So we called him up. Listen, we have the money. We want to pay you now. Last week, this is last Friday, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. Imagine, after we are handed over the note, the property note for the land, he takes his checkbook and he writes $10,000 donation to the project. He says, it's the first time I deal with Muslims, and I'm a businessman. You guys didn't break your word. You've been honest, and I appreciate that. And I would like to support your cause. This is the change we want to make in America as a community. Brothers and sisters in Islam. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. أقم الصلاة.
فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.